Shout it, shout it out loud.
Hey, everybody shout it now.
Shout it, shout it, shout it out loud.
Oh yeah!
I need my spicy ginger.
It will be disgusting to some, titillating to others. But whether it disgusts you or titillates you, it is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Yeah, March 24th, 2014. You know what that is. 5 short days away from my birthday. So I hope you guys are ready to come over to the to our home and celebrate with me on Saturday, March 29th. And for you listeners, you still have 5 shopping days left. So make sure you get your packages in the mail.
Kind of like how you showed up to the bachelor party that was here a few weeks ago.
Exactly like that.
It's all about him. He wants people to come to his parties. He doesn't go to anybody else's parties.
What a pair of ball nuts.
I let them use the donut. Isn't that enough?
They wanted you here.
No, they wanted me to meet them at the casino.
Well, that's...
At midnight.
That's a waste of time.
I'm like a grandpa
now. That changes things.
Yeah, I fall asleep.
Casino is just the absolute... Just a walking cemetery.
It is, right?
It is. It's
especially
terrible.
Around here.
Well, yeah. I don't know how it is in Vegas. Never been there. Don't care, but...
Yeah.
Just terrible. Terrible scene.
Nick dropping bombs on the casino industry.
Oh, jeez.
What did he drop?
Sorry, yeah, I was a little slow.
Walking cemetery. He's actually not that far off.
Yeah. Have you been there?
Oh, yeah. We were there
the most dismal looking people.
Jim Norton, Artie Lang, comedy gig.
Yeah, Nick DiPaolo. And who was the fourth one? Dave Attell at that one.
There you go.
Yeah, the anti-social network or whatever that was called.
Just the most
it was pretty good. Entertaining.
Yeah, but yeah, you're right, Nick. Especially in this area, it's kind of depressing because
people might not know, actually. We live near Chicago in Northwest Indiana,
mm-hmm.
and we actually have, it's fairly new. It's only been, I don't know, 15 years, if that, a somewhat thriving cruise liner boat type casino industry going on around here.
Yeah, because it's still illegal in Chicago. I mean, once they change that, nobody's coming here anymore. I don't know. Maybe they'll stay in business with all the trash around here who likes to spend their whole paycheck hoping to hit it big.
It's a dismal environment.
You know, it's not my job to tell you what to do with your money, so I don't care. But you do get the feeling when you're there that these people have no business spending that money.
Yeah.
But whatever. I don't care.
Gambling is a nasty addiction, man.
Yeah, that's no good.
That one will ruin you with a quickness.
Yeah.
In a really bad way, too. Just destroy you financially.
What's the name of the guy who gets pushed out the window by the... By the one-armed bandit in that Twilight Zone episode?
Franklin Gibbs.
Franklin. Yeah, you go.
Oh, that's a great episode.
What did he have, gambling debt?
He did.
He got bit by the gambling bug with a quick... He was anti-gambling, and they ended up in Vegas. His wife won a trip out there, and he ended up perishing
gambling
addiction.
Yeah. That's what happens. You know,
Franklin Gibbs.
Nick, have you ever gambled at all? Or not really.
I got $5 in chips one time. I spent $2. I cashed out $3. Took my $3 home. See? Gave them $2.
He gambled that one time. He didn't use a condom.
Yeah, but he hit it big that time. Right, I'm assuming. I'm assuming you're happy that you have a son, is what I'm
getting.
I don't know what you guys are talking about.
One time he almost contracted the STD.
I wish this podcast would stay out of my pants.
We can't help it. You know, you got those basketball pants on over there with enough room for 2 more hands.
Big snake slithering around under that loose-fitting fabric.
Nick had a Little Caesars on his lap earlier. It reminded me of Big Sausage Pizza. But I was going to say about gambling. Chris, I'm sure you've done this, and this is something that I noticed, you know, after going a couple times with my friends right when I turned 21, you first start gambling. It seems like a fun thing to do, like, oh, let's go to the boat. Let's go gamble. All right, let's go. And you go, you're having a good time. You might have a couple drinks. And then somebody wins and somebody loses, and the dynamic completely changes from fun to fuck that guy. He won. I should have won. I drove here and he won.
He owes me dinner and gas.
Yeah, and you get like you start fighting with each other. And then when you're winning, you can't like be happy about it because you know this guy lost.
You know, Chris said gambling can make you nasty.
It's evil.
It doesn't take long. A couple hands and that.
Franklin Gibbs. He was dead within 15 minutes.
You know, this guy might have had a point, but one time specifically, I'm thinking a friend of mine, and this is like, shit, I don't even know if I was 21. Shit.
Hell yeah.
This is like long before I had any bread in my pocket. Not that I'm like rich, but you know, I had nothing. And
rolling deep now.
Deep.
Yeah.
But also, I think, I don't even know if I had like an ATM card. That's how long ago this was. So I didn't have any money. And this guy's like, oh, let's go to the casino. And I was like, I don't know. I got like 10 bucks. He's like, I'll spot you 20. I'm like, you sure? He's like, yep. I said, okay, I'll pay you back. Spotted me 20. I got lucky and got like 250. And he lost money. He didn't want the 20 back. He wanted the whole 250 back because he afforded me the opportunity to make 20 that back. Money.
Yeah.
I gave him the 20.
Yeah, you can't dictate what... I mean... If you flushed it down the toilet in 2 minutes, what would he demanded? You pay him back? That's where I thought you were going with it, is that he gave me 20 bucks. I lost it in 30 seconds, and he was pissed off and wanted me to pay him. Wanted to go through a drive-through teller on the way back to get it. This is even worse.
That sounds like the kind of guy who would sucker punch someone from behind.
Nick, it sounds like you know who I'm talking about, and you've seen this happen. Yeah.
I haven't seen it happen, but it sounds like the individual, yeah.
Familiar story. Nick is dropping.
I'm feeling my oats tonight. with these basketball pants on.
I think we can all agree that's a bullshit move on that guy's part.
Yeah, it was absolutely bullshit, horse shit, dog shit, chicken shit. It was no good. But I gave him his 20 back. Bought him some 50s diner hamburgers that aren't 50s diner. You know, the place that looks
the
like
shoot
it
burger?
Is. No, at the casino they had a place. Oh. I don't even know if they still do. This is like,
I don't know,
10 years ago.
The casino is just...
It's a cesspool.
Used to have a great buffet.
They shitted it up.
They got rid of most of the good stuff and raised the price, and it's like, forget it.
Well, they dropped
it. Do go to the casino, but just for the food.
I had in the past.
Well, how do you know the buffet's gone to shit?
Because last time I was there.
Which was when?
When did we go to the terrible Bobby Knight thing that we talked
probably
about?
Probably 5 years ago, 4 years ago.
About four, maybe
I
almost
thought it was
four.
Pretty good when we went a couple summers
ago. Yeah,
it was all right.
It was not as good as it used to be.
Well, oh, Nick,
okay, sorry, Mr. Aristocrat.
Emeril Lagasse over here, however you say his name.
Bam.
Nick Prudhomme.
Yeah, I don't know. Casino buffets, that's something. That's a whole other discussion.
That's a whole other hole in the...
Well, you know, you have to have reasonable expectations, basically.
Yeah.
It's like listening to this podcast. you're not going to get a high level of quality.
Well, you might get entertainment, but you're not going to get a high level of intelligence.
We're not going to say we got Doc McGee on the line here. You know?
That's not happening.
Yeah, we don't drop the celebrity interviews or focus disproportionately on the gossip. This podcast is about the music. That's one of the things I take pride in about this podcast is, yeah, we get in some banter and talk about current events that are going on with KISS. We'd be remiss if we didn't, but in the basis of every episode is a song from the KISS catalog. Therefore, this podcast is about the music.
There you go.
So if you don't like it, go fuck yourself.
Damn, dog.
Get out of here.
Who said they didn't like it?
I'm just saying,
just
you know, so
preemptive
there
strike.
Are other podcasts out there that if you want to hear a bunch of guys fucking pontificating about the gossip, go over there. This is not the you know, if you're you know, if you think KISS sucks and they're not as highfalutin as Jethro Tull, get the fuck out of here. This is not for you.
Bam.
So anyway, I'm off my soapbox.
Fair enough.
Before I get a pie in the face. And Nick, what's the merch? What did they send you?
Well, you know what? They sent me... they actually didn't send me anything this week.
They.
I went to the Village Discount Center in Hammond, Indiana, which is a basically Salvation Army type store.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of used items. And we have something here which I'm hoping is not used.
Oh, boy.
It's
this from, could go a lot of bad directions. It's
from 87... Apparently, Paul Stanley, during the Crazy Nights era, had gone into a men's undergarment type of line.
I believe that.
That he released that didn't really succeed.
Mm-hmm.
Based
off of the undergarment that he was wearing on the back cover.
Sort of Zubaz inspired.
Of Crazy Nights. And well, I mean, you guys know what he was wearing, right? You could kind of see. He had that blue teal thong.
Yeah.
On the back cover.
On the back cover.
I love that picture.
Based off of like the thong, it's kind of strange. The name of the company, I don't know what happened to this company, but they called it David and Goliath.
the slingshot.
It's kind of like the slingshot, yeah.
Didn't it become Dolce and Gabbana? The same initials.
Could be.
D&G.
But yeah, I'm hoping, I don't know if I'm going to end up wearing this thing, but I found
it. Oh, I hope not.
No, because it's probably used, so.
Yeah, 9 months, Benny's going to have a little sibling if you throw that shit on.
So what do you do? Look in the rear side of it and see what song is spelled out? Streak mark?
Yeah, I was going to say.
that's exactly what I'm going to do.
Is that it?
It's a thankless job, but I do it for the fans.
All right, we'll put on your hazmat suit because you never know whose poop that is.
Right. So reading the tea leaves and see what we got.
This one comes off.
Unmasked.
It's called
Easy As It Seems.
Hmm.
Interesting.
Okay.
All right.
I'll take this.
Let's collectively breathe a sigh of relief that we didn't get a third Elder song in a row.
Thank God.
It would have been a quasi doing the whole album in its entirety, as some people want us to do.
We had two in a row, but we had another one not too far removed.
Yeah,
from
we've
that,
been
right?
plagued by Elder.
I have to look, but I don't remember the order of these damn shows.
Dangerously close to bringing this podcast to its knees. So I think we're staggering back up to one knee with this Unmasked song.
We're doing like Hogan and Andre doing the what do they do when they put their hand
the test of strength
where Hogan's on both knees and he gets on one and feeds off the crowd. We're looking to feed off the crowd so
we're hulking up right now.
We're hulking
feed
up.
Off the crowd. They've been launching barbs in our direction.
That's why we need them now more than ever.
And the fact that we kind of two of us liked. I'll fight hell to hold you. We caught some flack.
Yeah,
that.
I don't understand.
You know what?
How anyone could banish that one?
Hey guys, really, everyone's entitled to their own opinion.
Yeah,
they absolutely are.
And you know,
as puzzling as they
don't
may
say
be,
it.
It's puzzling. That's all.
As puzzling as people, it's. I guess that's one of the fun things about this podcast.
I thought you were.
Somebody will say, "Oh, well, that I love that song," and then you'll think, "Like, oh, well, they probably like this one." Oh, I hate that song. You know,
yeah,
that's how we are. That's how everybody is.
Well, that's what fosters discussion.
Exactly.
Here's what you have to understand as a Kiss fan: we're our own little pocket here. So, I think some of the things we like and dislike, we probably influenced each other a little bit. I'm not saying we all like the exact same things, but I mean, Nick and I are brothers. We grew up listening to this. We had certain Kiss albums. We didn't have certain Kiss albums. So we're more familiar with some stuff than others. Whatever childhood memories they bring up are different for different people. Chris had his own experiences, and we've discussed all this stuff for years before we started doing the podcast. But it might be different for you than it is for us. So that's where our opinions come from.
Well, exactly. And that's the other unique thing we have going on here is we have, multi-generations represented here, whereas other podcasts, they all seem about the same age, they all seem to have the same preferences, and
we got a guy in his 30s, a guy in his 20s, and a late teen twink over here.
We got the twink, the Twitter twink, as he was
little
called.
Rock
You got the man child and the elder and the boy.
Twink. So little. Unmasked, as I've said before in previous episodes, I know not everybody listens to every episode. In fact, probably a scant few people listen to every episode. But
and thank you for doing so.
Unmasked is sort of where I jumped off the train, speaking of the generational thing. I mean, Unmasked came out, what, 79?
80.
80?
May 29. 80.
Were you guys born?
I was a month and some change.
Okay.
At that point.
Nick was, or Andy was not. I bailed.
I was a devilish look in my dad's eye.
He was not being careful that night.
No, he wasn't.
I had jumped off the Kiss train at this point. Was way into Dynasty, but then in 79, I discovered Van Halen 2 and Highway to Hell, and with those two albums, I went off in a different direction.
I could see that.
If you wanted something with testosterone in it, Kiss was not doing it at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And those two albums absolutely.
Yeah,
were.
That's actually a good description. You know, although I liked Dynasty, I liked the harder edge of the albums. Two albums I mentioned, but Unmasked, I literally wasn't aware that it was ever even released until several years later. And then when I saw it, I was like, was that a greatest hits album? What was it? You know,
have we talked about the cover?
I don't think we've talked about it. I mean, we've only done what makes
we
the world
one,
go
yeah.
round.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which might be the song I was thinking of last week when I couldn't think of a song that I didn't enjoy.
That's a Paul song.
That was?
Yeah, it was Paul.
What the hell am I thinking of?
What are you talking about?
What makes the world go round?
Yeah, it's Paul.
I'm confused.
Oh, come on.
I'm so confused.
Can I tell my my story about how I came about purchasing this cassette tape?
Yes.
Of course.
I was in third
grade.
All right,
we're out of time today.
I was in third grade.
Okay.
And
were
I
you
had,
holding in a diarrhea?
I had.
Like you're meeting with Paul?
Yeah.
I had my teacher in grade school claimed to have
slid that teal thong down.
Claimed
Mary Kate Letourneau.
She claimed to have to have known a girlfriend of Peter Criss's.
Damn right she did.
And
was she her nurse?
And she told me.
Get it?
Andy had her too.
He tossed her down the stairs. Okay,
good.
Go ahead.
And this teacher saw that I had like a little Ace Frehley patch that we got from the flea market.
Yeah.
She's like, oh, do you like Kiss? I said, yeah, I love them. They're my favorite band. And she said, have you ever seen, you ever heard of the album Unmasked? I'm like, no, I don't think so. She's like, oh, inside of the cover of that is a picture from that time period. It was the first time the original members took a photo and put it in an album without their makeup.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, oh, well, that's interesting. Like, I'd seen all the members without their makeup since then.
Yeah.
But from that era, I thought, oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And it's a Kiss album, so it's got to be great, right? So,
right.
So it's probably a year or two later, whenever I was able to scrounge up enough money, our dad took me to Old Woodmar Records in Hammond, Indiana, and I purchased the tape. My dad let me throw it in the tape player.
Yeah.
I played the tape.
That must have been an interesting ride.
During Is That You, when it first started, the overall sonic quality of the album, the more restrained, kind of almost poppy, whatever,
mm-hmm.
rubbed me the wrong way. And I was like asking my dad, like, since I opened this, can I like not take this back?
That's not a good review.
And, no, but you know what? Since then, it's grown on me, and I'm a pretty big fan of the Unmasked album.
What did that have to do with the cover, though?
Yeah, we were
well.
That whole story that
because
she
it's
told
not
you?
Because it wasn't true.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
Yeah,
because
I don't
true.
Know for whatever reason that teacher lied, and
what,
she also
what was, yeah. what was she? Why was she lying?
I don't. But she also lied.
Why did she lie to you?
She also lied about
trying to get your pants off.
She also, I'm pretty sure, lied about her knowing Peter Criss's girlfriend,
well,
which we'll get into line. That in a different podcast. I'll
she
tell
she did,
story.
However, fuck Dominique Wilkins in a hot tub once.
It was Andy's kindergarten teacher.
Yeah, okay. Since you brought it up, I do have a quick story about her. I was in kindergarten, and I had to take a dump.
This is more what Chris was asking
yeah.
for. Yeah.
I tell this story all the time to my wife. I don't know why, but This is the only time from kindergarten until I was in college where I ever took a dump out of school. First year of school, kindergarten, had to take a dump. So I'm in there crapping, right? In my own, in the bathroom, privacy. A couple minutes later, the teacher comes in. It's like, Andy, are you okay? And I'm like, yeah. Thinking that's weird. You know, I'm 5 years old. Like, what the hell's going on? She's like, oh, I brought some books for you. And she slid them under the stall to me. Isn't that a bizarre thing to do when a kid's taking a dump?
Yeah, that's not proper.
The weird thing is they were sex books. Man, I made that up.
It was Pelican Brief.
It was all Kama Sutra stuff she wanted to try out with me.
Oh, boy.
I was a hot kid.
You look, dirty about, look about the same now.
Yeah.
She punched exactly. out some erasure on their cassette player.
It's the wrong wanted band. He doesn't like that.
I don't care. I established it.
Terrible right. Joy Division.
Oh, you're gonna
he's going to be mad.
Heat. You're going to catch some heat.
This is not the first time Arturo and I have clashed on something. We can rise above it. It's what we talked about earlier. Differences of opinion are what make things interesting.
You're right.
So I don't know anything about the crap music he listens to.
Damn.
I just threw out Erasure. Because isn't that the same shit? Mopey Robert Smith type crap.
Don't don't even talk about Morrissey to me.
Well,
I'm gonna lose it.
Level. You're gonna lose a lot of listeners.
I'm gonna lose Bob McLean if I start talking about. Start talking about how
is
much
it really
I hate
a bad
Morrissey.
Thing to lose Bob McLean?
Wow, that's I a bomb yes. right there too.
I appreciate
yeah. Bob McLean. All right.
If Bob McLean is out of the picture, you pay much less in tolls. That's all I'm going to say.
Wow.
Damn.
Bombs.
Bombs. So let's get back on track.
See,
here.
If he paid fewer tolls, fewer tolls, he could afford so many more Billy Joe Armstrong signature guitars.
Chris is breaking balls and knocking down walls.
Damn, he sure is. So you want to get into it?
Yeah,
of course we
do. We all know this one, or Chris?
I was talking about Unmasked because I'm complete, except for Shandy, which Andy, he described it to me and I couldn't believe it, so I went and looked it up on YouTube. This was years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But aside from that, in the one we've done already,
couldn't believe it.
Well, it was
funny.
It just didn't. It didn't compute how it was a hit single in Australia and all this other shit.
Right.
So that and the one we already did, I've heard obviously, but everything else I'm completely unfamiliar with. So
right. Well, for those of you who are also unfamiliar, before we start this, again, this came out May 29th, 1980, Unmasked. This is a time when the band was kind of crumbling. Peter Criss, I don't think, played at all on it, right? It's Anton Figg.
Peter Criss, from what I understand, had nothing to do with this album.
So in
whatsoever.
The public, they made it seem like we're still a tight band with four guys. But in the studio, the drummer from David Letterman's playing drums on all these songs. And there might even, I mean, geez, there's probably several. There's a different session bassist. I think Paul played bass on, was that on this?
Played bass on at least one song, yeah.
Yeah, so they're kind of all over the place here. Different songwriters.
It was probably, they all had their own entourages, and it was, you know, just a fragmented band.
Yeah,
at
just
that
a
point.
Complete mess, really.
Yeah. So, I don't know. We'll see what we think. I know what I think. I have some opinions
on
this song
already. Know what I'm going to say about this one, yeah.
But
this is one that I hear.
Let's
frequently.
Crank it up to the sky, huh?
Crank it up to the sky, all right.
All right, here we go. Easy as it seems.
So let's just start off by saying we have... I Was Made for Loving You was a huge hit off of Dynasty.
Right. The vibe.
We have the quote-unquote big bass pounding up your wazoo or whatever he says.
Right.
We've got the disco vibe happening again.
Yep. Same
thing. I'm not really getting a disco vibe off that.
No? I got it.
I did.
No, I'm not getting it. I'm getting a weird vibe that probably no one has made this connection, but... I'm making it now because this song came up in my shuffle recently. See You in Hell by Monster Magnet.
I don't know that
getting
one.
Getting a very
nor do I.
Strong connection vibe from that. So.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. Right before it starts, I want to make a quick comment. I don't know if I ever realized that there are those hand percussion drums in there.
I was just going to say that, yeah.
I don't know. Sometimes when you listen in the headphones, it's a little more clear. It's probably something we had on tape that we listened to 100 times in the Chevy Lumina driving around, so you don't pick up the
I remember hearing
subtlety.
I remember hearing it back on the tape.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking, like, this might be the first and only song in the Kiss catalog
that
features
it's neither. Almost
Human,
baby.
Almost
Human,
yes.
That's another one that came up in Shuffle
good
recently.
Call.
That's the fucking... somebody's going ape shit on the congas.
With the gong.
Yeah, that's a great one, man. I'm looking forward to that episode. That's a kick-ass tune. But yeah, following in the footsteps of Almost Human.
Yep.
I'm liking this so far. I like the bouncy feel of it, gotta admit. Same with the Paul song we did a few episodes ago from this album. I'm fine with it.
And speaking of which, here comes Mr. Paul Stanley. What do we got? What do we got? Let's see. You know what? It's.
I've been your lover for so many years.
Too many, I think.
Yeah.
Too many. When do you get to the point where it's been too many years that you've been someone's lover?
I think one.
Is it just depending on the situation?
Yeah, I think so.
Like, what if it was like 23 years? Mm-hmm. Would that be too long?
It's just person
too
to person.
Too many years.
It's person to person. And for Paul Stanley, he was probably, 27, 28 years old when they made this. That was too many years.
Too many.
Whatever it was, 1-2 years, I don't know. Too many.
I know that a lot of people regard... Well, I mean, I guess it's pretty much a fact that this album had... It was a more calculated, tighter sound... not as heavy really, but there's still some heavy elements in here, even though it's still, to me, it's really got that disco feel. It's a very interesting song.
I don't hear anything heavy, which isn't a bad
thing.
Well,
I mean,
I kind of like it.
But
so
I mean,
far.
It's sort of, it's still got some rockiness to it.
Well,
it,
sure.
I mean,
absolutely.
It's when you hear it at the beginning, you're like, oh, what are they doing? You know, this is like straight, like Lou Rawls.
No, I didn't
my
get love that.
And
I think
of stuff,
you're off base with that.
Which I love that stuff, too. But
I didn't
anyway.
Get that impression at all.
I'm hearing like Disco Inferno and all kinds of stuff here.
I get that.
But it's still
must be an age thing. I'm getting it.
We didn't live through it, so maybe we have a different opinion.
Well, I didn't. I lived through it, and it's as if it didn't even exist. Is what I'm saying. Is I had no even this. The fact this album even came out, I didn't even realize it. So.
What the hell?
What the hell have you
shut
done?
Up, lady?
Shut that shit off.
Would anything else surprise
Revolution
you
will not be
bitch.
Televised.
Jesus,
that makes me mad.
What is this horse shit?
Some stupid lyrics website.
Get out of here.
Starts playing a video in the background.
Bastards.
Nobody wants
never
that.
Going to that site again.
What is
shit.
It?
Let's tell everybody
I
to
don't know. 1-2-3 lyrics.
Tell Ellen DeGeneres to crash that website.
It looked like is Miley Cyrus yeah. on there with her... Soupy, narrow ass. Get off our screen.
Soupy.
All right, let's go back.
All right. I pulled it back a little bit.
Pull it back.
Chris laughed.
No.
I love that. I just love the sleeping with line that Peter used in the I'm Gonna Love You and Now Here.
What did he say in that one?
You know, don't let me find you sleeping with another
man. Oh, yeah,
when,
yeah.
When Peter used it, it was a warning.
Yeah.
Or more of a promise, really. And when Paul's using it here, he's portraying a very vulnerable person in this song.
Yeah, it's
different. And that's kind
for
of
him.
A
jealous guy.
Kind of a turnoff for you know, if a Kiss fan's listening to this, you don't. I don't know. Do you want vulnerability? in that way that I don't think I can. I don't think I have a handle.
For whatever reason, I'm not minding it. I just think it's funny, and also like you know,
it's funny.
I hear you're sleeping with one of my friends. Tell me why? Because he's a great lay. I don't know why else.
Richie Kotzen.
Why else would I be sleeping with him? He's got a huge cock. I mean, why else would I be sleeping with your friend?
Those are two.
I mean,
good
what's
reasons.
She gonna say? How is she gonna answer that question?
He's the ultimate twink.
That's it. That's probably what the answer is.
Is anybody else hearing
keyboard.
That? Yeah, that's yeah, the synth is.
That's a legitimate disco.
Well, hold on to your hats.
What? It gets worse
or better?
It's all in the eye or the ear of the beholder, I guess.
What do you think?
I actually like this for whatever reason, kitschy or whatever. I am enjoying this so far. I'm good with it.
I believe I've mentioned I'm a pretty big Lionel Richie fan.
Yeah,
that's something that I could hear him doing in some of his older songs.
Yeah,
I can appreciate it. I mean, it's
yeah. I'm trying to make a similar connection, but I know where you're going.
It's Kiss, and you've got Ace Frehley.
Well, it's totally
off
kilter.
Yeah.
Anything that
departure is a good word,
and it's just unbelievably wimpy. But for that exact reason, I kind of like it. I don't know. I don't know how to explain it, but
it's,
I like this.
It's
one.
Not a bad song at all thus far.
I agree.
Boyfriend now. They're not lovers.
They've been going steady
for.
Well,
there is
too
a fine line there between lovers and boyfriend.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, definitely.
Lovers is sort of the outset where you're just drawn to each other for the sex, right?
Mm-hmm.
Once you get to the boyfriend level, that's when you're like, you know, you got to do stuff.
You got to go to Home Depot.
You got to drive her car. Drive her car, that's a good
that's
one.
That's Andy's favorite.
Yeah, that's when it crosses the line.
I think when it goes from lovers to boyfriend is when she... It crosses that line at the instant when the first time she refuses you sex. That's when you stop being her lover and you start being
her
boyfriend.
She says, get out of my face, man child.
Or just like, no, I'm not in the mood or I have a headache, whatever the trite refusals are.
Look at that.
And
I
then
just
you
became
keep,
a boyfriend.
And then you keep coming back.
Yep.
You're the boyfriend now. You're not a hot lover anymore.
If you would have taken off, you'd be hot lover.
Right.
Turn up the heat.
Yeah. But. It happens to all of us.
Yeah, well, that tipping point has clearly been...
happens to some of you.
Happens to some of you, yeah.
That tipping point has clearly been crossed here, so no wonder
he's a wreck. He's an emotional wreck in this
song. That's another thing that comes with the boyfriend status. You start to get fucked with emotionally. Nobody wants that.
You know, there's somebody that we all know.
Oh, no.
That can help us.
I went way too far in that direction.
When we're in need like this.
Well, who is it?
Oh, well, he's a guy wearing basketball pants. We're in the... I hope you guys don't mind me yelling like that every time I walk into Throat Donut Studio.
No, that's cool. That's our little way of...
Yeah, that's
great.
That's
how you establish dominance, and we all listen to you for about 30 seconds before Chris pipes up over there.
I know what I'm talking about.
Well, let's hear it. What do you got today, Dr.
I
Nick?
Keep telling yourself that.
I will tell you, and you will agree, because I've got some advice for the Paul Stanley version that we're getting in this song, and anybody who's going through a relationship like this, whether it's suspicious, it's sort of... The Elvis Presley hit Suspicious Minds. We're kind of getting the same theme. We can't go on together with Suspicious Minds.
Like every lover I've had.
And if the relationship has not reached a level of commitment where there's a lot invested in it, my advice would be, it's true. You probably can't go on together with Suspicious Minds.
Damn.
I'm sorry, but it's not going to if you say, oh, well... a lot of people say, well, I'll get engaged and then, you know, all of the stuff will stop, or
yeah,
I'll get married and all this will stop.
It, or we'll have a baby. Yeah, that'll fix it.
Yeah, it just doesn't typically. Of course, there are exceptions to every rule, but it typically does not happen.
A baby is not a Band-Aid.
That is exactly the truth.
But people try it.
But people do it.
Yeah.
So that's my advice to the lovelorn and distraught version of Mr. Stanley that we're hearing here.
Well, it to have these thoughts is just indication of a basic non-existence of trust. And if that's not going on, you can't have a relationship. You certainly shouldn't cross over to the boyfriend zone. Once that sets in, just, you know, cut it clean. I was a lover, and I'm going to end it there. I'm going to cut out on top or on the bottom, whatever is appropriate. But
is that it for Dr. Nick?
Yes, I'm going.
I got a good
take your dollar and fucking beat it.
Good segment, though.
Oh, he even yells on the way out, too.
Well, even a broken clock is right twice a day. So
there you go. All right, let's dive back in. You know what's driving me wild. I've seen you crying without any tears like a child. You wonder all the reasons why. It's easy as it seems. And it's easy as it seems. When you're walking out. Chris is loving it over there.
I love this one. It's a good, I really do.
It's good. One thing I am noticing, I think we talked about the bass before.
This is a great bass line.
I'm thinking almost with certainty that's not Gene Simmons.
Yeah, probably not.
I'm sure we've got our buddies out there who listen to the podcast, and they may have access to some information that we obviously have not accessed yet. Maybe someone out there could verify this. But this bass line, to me, does not at all sound like Gene Simmons. I'm going to guess Ace Frehley had nothing to do with this.
It's some hot session cat.
I'm thinking it was, Paul Anton Figg and someone else.
Lionel Richie's bass player.
Probably, Bootsy Collins.
Could be.
No, Bootsy would have been more busy. Little filter going on. This sounds like a studio cat, which is fine, man.
Hey, it's
bouncy.
Yeah,
it's good.
It's not necessarily just walking bass line. It's like a hopping, skipping, running bass line.
It's very strange because all the elements taken separately, I should hate it. And any Kiss fan from the old days should hate it. But the sum of the parts, I'm loving it.
It happens.
It's like McDonald's. I'm loving it.
Wait.
Ace or no?
Oh, man. If that's not Ace, then that's a really good impression. Except for those last few notes. That's pretty uncharacteristic. But everything else, it's pretty close, man. It could very well. I could have been wrong earlier when I said Ace probably had nothing
solo.
To do with it.
I liked it.
Yeah. It was with this disco-y kind of departure from Kiss. From their overall style, the solo, it's the same kind of Kiss solo
kinda
that
ties it back together.
It's very,
was
very
Bob Kulick in the picture during this era?
We may have to ask him on May 17th at the Indie Expo.
Oh, yeah.
You don't
are we
think he's
going to
be back?
No, I have no idea if he's
going to
be back.
I wonder who this special guest is going to be.
But by the time this podcast comes out, we might know who's going to be there.
When does Paul Stanley's book come out?
On a very, very important day in our world's history of all time.
That's right.
The must have.
Yep.
It's the Bible.
Yeah, he is just talking smack to get that book sold.
We'll get to that.
He's getting press.
Bob Kulick was a songwriter on Unmasked. It doesn't say that he was a session guitar player, but who knows?
But you can assume that he might have been.
I could hear him playing this solo.
Yeah. Well, I take it back a couple seconds just so we don't jump right back into the vocals, but here we go.
If it takes forever, I
You like that?
Yeah.
Nick and Chris are both rocking over there, man. You guys are going to clunk your heads together.
This song has a lot of
careful.
Energy. I mean, for an album that's not considered one of their most energetic, this song has got me moving.
It's also kind of it's pretty well produced. It sounds good. I mean, there's some space in there. The drums sound pretty good for the period, you know. Certainly way better than, you know, the early Sunset Strip version of the band. Yeah, it's clean, it's professional, it's good. I like it.
Paul's taking it up a notch there.
Man.
After the success of...
He's in pain. He's a jealous man.
Yeah, his falsetto on I Was Made for Loving You.
Oh, well, we've got almost the same note coming up here, I believe.
Yep.
Really?
Can you imagine if, like, you found out your girlfriend was cheating on you, or your lover, and that's the noise, that was your reaction, that high-pitched?
you turned into Prince all of a sudden?
Yeah.
What is easy? What is easy as it
I'm
seems?
Not, you know,
cheating?
I have no idea.
Philandering?
I have no idea. Unless he's saying...
Sleeping with your boyfriend.
You just walk away. It's easy as it seems. Is that the... When you walk out on your dreams...
You just walk away.
It's easy to trash a relationship that maybe you shouldn't.
It's easy to take Dr. Nick's advice earlier. I don't know.
Yeah. It's easy to send a gift to Throat Donut Studio for my birthday.
Yeah.
Long fade here.
And what about how tight is the drumming on this song?
Well,
I mean, come on, it's Anton Fig.
Come on,
a drum
monster.
Machine. It reminds me of the Pot of Thunder theme song. It's that tight.
It is that tight.
It's on that level.
It's on the hi-hat level. Top
work.
Shelf. Yep.
So, I don't know. Should we just get into the ratings for this one?
Let's do it. I'll go first. I like to
I
go
think
first.
I should go first because my
Man.
Vote is obvious.
Dropping bombs.
Okay,
well, I mean, is it any secret from what I have my commentary throughout this song that I'm giving this a major hallelujah?
I don't like going after you because you leave a mess.
Yeah, well, you will too when you're my age.
All right. So,
but yeah, I think this song is great, man. I would totally add this to the shuffle queue and be happy when it came up out of nowhere. So
that's
hallelujah for
that's
me.
Essentially Chris's Hall of Fame of music.
Pretty much.
The shuffle queue.
And what is your iPod? Don't you have one of those giganto ones?
Well, I have a classic.
But I mean, I don't mean physically. I mean...
Oh, 120 gigs?
Yeah, that's insane.
Oh, it's not full. It's not even half full yet.
Okay, because I have the 16 gigabyte iPhone and that's all I use at this point. I don't even use my iPod anymore. But yeah... I was going to say, to get in the rotation, it's got to be special when you've only got 16 gigs to work with. But with 120, I can't even think, I don't think I even have owned that much music if I took every CD I ever owned and put it on.
Yeah, I think I'm only up to about 35-40% storage used.
Damn.
I need to download some more crew videos.
More than one? You've got some on there?
Yeah, with Saints of Los Angeles on iTunes, you got the title cut and Motherfucker of the Year videos.
Damn, didn't know they made those.
Yeah.
I knew the Saints of Los Angeles. I didn't know about the second one. But Nick, do you want to vote or do you want me to vote?
You could go.
I'll go ahead.
Don't do it.
You know, this song. Let's make annoying noises in that answer. Keep people in suspense. I give it a hallelujah. I like everything about it. Again, if you're a traditional first six album Kiss fan, might not be for you.
Hey, I am, and I like it.
Yeah,
so.
But, I mean, I think of you as a little bit more than that.
I think a lot of people would be appalled by the overall style and sound of it.
Well,
I guess,
like I said, take it if you take all the elements apart separately, these are things that the old school Kiss fans should hate.
Yeah, we
but
have...
somehow you blend them together, for me anyway, and the sum of the parts is pretty dang good.
Yeah.
So.
We have said this before, like, oh, you know, that's just not what you want from Kiss. That might be what you could say about this song, but it's good. But and we like it, so it gets a hallelujah. I like it. I like the music, like the actual writing. This is something I've thought about before. If you took this song and produced it a different way, just, you know, how it is written on paper, and produced it like more hard rock instead of disco dancey, it could be great in another way, a different way than it is now. It's, I think it works several different ways. It's just a good song. I like it. Hallelujah.
So no tipping point vote from Nick, but I'm interested to get his take on it.
Well, I mean,
I don't say that very often.
Is at first when you hear it, it's jarring because you're thinking back to like, okay, well, like I said earlier, I Was Made for Loving You is what arguably their biggest hit, right? Commercial hit. So,
of Beth co- was of, probably bigger.
Well, maybe. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but possibly their biggest hit. And so it makes perfect sense that they would kind of want to stick to that vein somewhat and see if, you know, lightning will strike twice. And I could see where that would be off-putting to a lot of people because it seems rather obvious that that's what they're doing. But it's like Andy was saying, it's, the song is a good song. It's a really good song, and it's played. I mean, Anton Figg on the drums. It drives it so well. Whoever's playing bass, good. You know, it's really nice chords that they let ring throughout the verse, and
solo is tight.
And the solo was nice. And even with the really extremely cheesy synthesizer solo and all that, it worked out. I mean, it was like, they said we're gonna have a song that's gonna be this style, and we're just gonna go all the way with it, and that's what they did. But there's almost ferocity in the playing in this song. So I mean, and Paul sounds great, and you know, so yeah, obviously hallelujah.
All right,
no doubt about it.
Three hallelujahs. Do you want me to tell you what Paul Stanley had to say about this song?
That would be a good person to ask.
Hey Paul, what do you think of this song? Or what do you have to say about it?
Paul,
I guess
it's S.
Paul S. He
Paul
sent
a, Paul A or Paul S?
Paul S.
Okay.
Paul A did not contribute any feedback on this song.
I wish he would sometimes.
Paul S. sent in this handwritten letter. Every week we get a handwritten letter from a member of the band telling us about the song. It has nothing to do with Kiss, Behind the Mask, the book. I was at my girlfriend's house and I woke up and I was singing this song. I was thinking of the Spinners. I never really saw Easy as It Seems as a song for us, but that's happened before. I'll come up with a song and have no intention of us doing it like Hard Luck Woman. Hard Luck Woman wasn't meant for us. It was like a Rod Stewart kind of thing, which we've heard a million fucking times. Paul, come on. About something new. I mean, thanks for the handwritten letter, but geez. Give us a nugget of new information.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah. Nothing really. I mean, even he's saying this isn't typical for us, but I think you could say that for a lot of Unmasked. You could say that for some of Dynasty. You could say that all of the Elder. I mean, this probably works more than a lot of that stuff, right? Don't you think?
For me, yeah.
For you, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't want to mention too many other songs that they've done that are like this that I enjoy, but because we haven't reviewed them yet, but. I mean, it works for me, and I, you know, we had years ago, I was in high school, we had a Chicago radio station briefly, 103.5 The Beat.
Yeah.
And they played a lot of, like, the disco-y, but not just straight disco. It was, like, a lot of, like, the sort of disco-y soul kind of stuff from this period and a little bit before that. And I really, like, got into just, I really enjoyed listening to the stuff on there, and that became a... something that I really liked. And this song, you know, it definitely a lot of influences from that style of music from that time period. So yeah.
Okay.
Awesome.
Well,
awesome. Awesome.
We have some other things we wanted to get into, but before we get into that, we have to do our weekly Hall of Fame induction. The Pod of Thunder Hall of Fame.
I think
inductee.
I heard the fax machine going off.
Now, is Tito Blackwell, is he only directing his submissions to you, Nick? Or
he's sending it to Throat Donut Studios.
Yeah, he sends a facsimile to Throat Donut Studios. Okay, actually, I've never seen this character, Tito Blackwell. I've never seen his face, but...
He's our number one fan.
Yep.
So let's just hope we don't get in a car accident out in a desolate cabin and he ends up taking care of us and finds out that we're doing something he doesn't like.
That would not be good. But you know what? That hasn't happened yet. So let's just enjoy Tito Blackwell and this week's... The week of March 24th, the Hall of Fame induction ceremony for Pod of Thunder. Here we go. Pod of Thunder co-host, Throat Donut Studios resident bass player and vocalist, a man who enjoys his international suites, classic middle child, the guy who gets to beta test all of the prototypes for questionable Kiss merchandise, grab a piece of pizza and a spicy ginger ale and toast this week's Pod of Thunder Hall of Fame inductee, Nick Jones. Woo! Nick, congratulations.
Thank you. Oh, it's great to have accomplished something like this. To be, you know, for posterity, I'm gonna be in the annals of
posterior anal.
I'm gonna be remembered for something. So it's great. I accept this on behalf of I don't know. I'm taking this for myself. You know what? Yeah. I did this.
You deserve it.
I did it. I earned it. So yeah.
You took a ride with a one way ticket.
And it's humbling. And it's humbling to be going after Andy, who of course is the obvious choice for the primary inductee. So it's an honor.
Well, I think that we should just stop.
It's an honor to be the Winchester to your Frank Burns.
I don't know what that means, but I think it sounds like a compliment.
MASH references.
Oh, is it? You know, I think that we should tell Tito Blackwell to just lose our number, and we should end the whole.
So that should be just the two. Yeah.
Two's good.
Well, we'll see.
Three's a crowd.
Hey, he's the one that runs it. We'll see next week what he's got for us.
We will
see. I can't imagine for the life of me who you would pick next.
I don't know. I don't get it. But we'll just have to wait till the week of March 31st to find out. But there are a couple things I wanted to get into before we wrap it up today. Nick, you talked about how this is a departure for Kiss, but it works. Can you think of any other musical departures that work? Doesn't have to be Kiss. It could be any band. But where they take the fork in the road, usually you'd say, ew, why are they doing that? But, you know, for whatever reason, it works.
There's one in particular I could think of that I really, really like, and it's definitely a rare song in the catalog of AC/DC.
Uh-huh.
It's off of, I don't know exactly which album, like U.S. release it was on, but I think it was the Australian version, like the initial version of High Voltage. There's a song called Love Song, and I think it's got like parentheses, O Gene or something like that. And it's like, it starts off just kind of like in between where it's sort of got like a rocky kind of element. So it's just kind of, it's a strange intro for AC/DC. But like then it's just straight love song sappy ballad, and I really like it. It's really like simple melody, just kind of sappy, and I don't know, it works for me. And that's AC/DC, you know, they're
they're balls to the wall.
Yeah,
all the time.
I mean, pretty much all the time. I would say that would be a departure.
Okay,
never even heard that.
No, what album was it from?
I think. You know,
is it
like
Brian
the AC,
Johnson
the
or Bon Scott?
It's Bon Scott. It's one of their first releases. It's the AC/DC catalog's so hard for, like, I'm not an expert at it, and there are so many different versions of things, and like they would just say, oh, well, this song was on the Australian version of this album, but the U.S. version of,
oh, really?
Yeah. So as far as I know, it's on like one of the High Voltages that I came across.
Okay,
but I really like it. I think it's a really good song.
Well, I have one now that you said that. I'm thinking. And I've got one that might be kind of controversial. I'm not sure how
that's good. We want that.
I'm not sure how most people feel about this. It could be something where if you were into it at the time, which I assume Chris was, that it might have some negative, it might bring up negative thoughts from you. But mine is when Van Halen started to work keyboards in the songs a little bit more.
Yeah, just like Easy As It Seems.
Yeah. And I mean, Jump, whatever, Jump's a hit. But the song I really like is I'll Wait.
That's a good song.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that song.
That's not, Show Your Love or whatever. It's not like a crazy, it's not Eddie going bananas on the guitar. It's a kind of a mid-tempo song. But
although he does say something about there's a magazine called Heartbreak and Motor Jive or something like that. So yeah. It's still Van Halen.
It's still Van Halen, but yeah, it's a departure.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, I was just about to say, that anybody doesn't think that David Lee Roth can write some great lyrics, there's an example. In fact, pretty much everything they've done has got some awesome lyrics in the David Lee Roth era. The guy was a great lyricist.
Even my favorite lyric from the newest album is he goes, I can't think of the name of the actual song, but he says, "How many roads must a man walk down before he admits he's lost?"
Mm.
I thought David Lee Roth parodying Bob Dylan, sort of.
Yeah.
Great. Fantastic stuff. And I know Chris, for a while, his catchphrase was "Stay Frosty." So
now it's "Be Careful."
Yeah, right.
Chris, do you have one?
The only thing that's coming to mind is around 1980, 81. You know, Kiss was not the only band of their ilk that was dabbling in different types of sounds. Alice Cooper came out with an album called Flush the Fashion in 1980.
Okay.
And the single from that album, Clones, very, just completely not what you would expect from him, but it's and then there's a lot of keyboard in it, the main lick, the main musical hook is on the keyboard.
Mm-hmm.
But I loved that song and that album. I should really take the plunge and download Flush the Fashion, because it's been years since I heard that whole album, but I remember liking the whole thing.
You got 80 gigs of space. What's taking so long?
I don't know. It slips my mind. It's on top of mind.
You know, when you said that. Alice Cooper, though, I was thinking, he's one of those artists where he pretty regularly does something out of character. So
the first time he really did that was when Only Women Bleed. I mean, when he came out with that single, it was kind of, the lyrics were certainly dark, but it was almost like a Tonight's the Night type Rod Stewart ballad around the time. So that was kind of the first foray into it. But I remember when Clones came out, he took a lot of flack for that, for the same reason Kiss took flack for the type of song we listen to today. And also, I Was Made for Loving You. I wouldn't go so far as to say it was disco, but it was more like Alice Cooper got bagged on for trying to be new wave, really. And I don't know. I liked it. I thought it was good.
I'll have to check that out. I'm not familiar with that.
Yeah. Me neither.
Clones from Flush the Fashion.
And there's there are, like Alice Cooper, there are a lot of bands that, like, you could say that about, but then throughout their careers, they kind of kept changing. Like, I was thinking STP from their first album to their second, there's definitely some stuff that's different, and definitely on their third album, and then further and further, it's like, but you can't really say, I guess, looking back in hindsight at the collective work of, you know, someone like that, or, I don't know. I'm kind of drawing a blank on other bands that do that. I was almost thinking Changes by Sabbath.
Yeah.
I mean, because that's... But see, Sabbath, they did some, you know, they did unexpected stuff sometimes anyway. So, I mean, can you really say it's out of character?
Well, the weird thing about Changes is it's on Volume 4, which is just a bludgeoning album, the rest of it, and the first of their triad of cocaine fueled releases that are just, you know, it's just a band on the edge, which those middle three albums of theirs are just such an engaging listen, because you can you can just hear the danger and the dysfunction in the music. But for changes to appear on that album was pretty off the wall.
I've got another one. I'm looking at my phone at the bands. Iron Maiden, Seventh Son of the Seventh Son. Moonchild is keyboards, which is like sacrilegious for keyboards in Iron Maiden, but I still like the song. It still works.
Or what, the Somewhere in Time? Pretty keyboard heavy, yeah.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I guess, but is it really a departure to that extent, as this Kiss song,
maybe,
you know?
You're right.
You could say, I can't think of the name of that Ramones song where it's got like the cheesy bells in the beginning along with the chord changes.
Someone Goes to Blitzburg.
I can't think of what song it was, but it was one of their 80s sort of quasi hits, and it's like, well, there are elements of it, but can you really say it's a departure? I don't know.
Hmm.
It's a tough question, actually. It took me a while to come up with that Alice Cooper suggestion, but I think that totally fits.
Nailed it right in the nick of time.
Well, how do you know? You have never even you haven't heard Clones.
Could you tell like by my reaction that I didn't? I was just pretending. You got to pump it up for the show, Chris.
Ah, fuck that.
What about, I mean, maybe this band doesn't count because they're kind of established early on. They just do whatever the hell. But I'm thinking the Faith No More King for a Day album.
See, that's another band where it's just like, yeah, that's sort of their forte.
Yeah.
Is that like, they just kind of...
Yeah, it's what they do.
Yeah. But then they did like Evidence and they had Gospel, Just a Man kind of thing. But yeah, at that point they could get away with whatever they wanted.
So I don't know that you could say that for all bands. That's almost, you know, it's not to that extreme, but you could say, oh, well, Mr. Bungle. It's like, Mr. Bungle, everything is a departure from everything that happened
before. Or like Frank Zappa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was his whole fucking shtick was to do something totally off-kilter every time out.
All right. Well, I think we nailed it. If anybody listening has something that's a departure that works, share it.
Post a video or something, whatever.
Post some nudes, whatever you want.
Some hot pics.
Yeah.
It's good.
Did you want to talk about Paul Stanley before we get out of here?
No.
No?
Not really.
We'll save it?
No, I mean...
Nick was talking on the way over to the donut today about how... Paul Stanley stir in the pot.
Well, I
mentioned
thinks it's,
intentionally.
I mentioned it several times.
To hype up the book. And I mean, we were talking about it off the air. I didn't know if he wanted to touch up on it.
Yeah, it just seems much more obvious now. I think everybody can tell that that's what he's doing. It's just, I mean, he's coming out with very aggressive things that
what did he
normally
say about
doesn't.
Other music memoirs?
He said something like almost all music memoirs are basically just good for toilet paper.
There you go. So he's basically saying this is the book that everyone needs.
Yeah, he's a master self-promoter, and I don't know if anybody else is, but I personally feel like I'm seeing through it. I'll still get the book, but I'm seeing through this sort of like, oh, all of a sudden he's got these quotes on Yahoo being interviewed by Rolling Stone. It's like, where did that come from?
Yeah, but hey, it's working. People are talking about it. He's getting everybody all worked up.
He's doing what he,
Kiss
he
knows
he
how
to
manipulate
do.
The populace the way they like, so.
Hey, you know, you're probably right about why he's doing it, but. I don't care. I just want to hear what he has to say. If he wants to talk trash, I want to hear it.
He wants other people to want to hear what he has to say.
If he wants to praise something,
yeah.
I want to hear it. I'm just interested in whatever that guy's saying. I can't wait for the book. I don't think it's going to bring the same joy that Peter Criss's book brought. Just filth, trash, wild party stories. I think Paul's will be a little bit more middle of the road.
Well, I wasn't going to talk about it too much, but since you brought that up, there was a great quote, and of course I'm paraphrasing, I don't have it in front of me, but from a few weeks back, he said how he was reading Gene's book, and he's like, well, a lot of it's true, but it's from Gene's point of view, and he's sort of so self-centered that it's distorted. And he said, well, and then he just kind of dismissed outright. He said, well, Ace and Peter as well. I mean, there's something along the lines of there's a reason why they don't let drug addicts and drunks on the witness stand.
Jeez. He's letting him have it.
That's
lately.
What I'm saying. Yeah,
they must have done something to him because it seems like Gene doesn't even care as much. You think Gene would be the guy all pissed off at Ace and Peter? But
Gene,
Paul is
when
pissed.
Gene's book came out. Did he do this? I don't think so.
Well, his book came out a long time.
I know,
ago.
But I don't remember like the social. Well,
I don't think
social media wasn't as prominent. But no. I don't remember like a social media blitz like this.
No. I think Paul's taking a different approach. But, you know, maybe he's just being interviewed more. Am I a fool to think it's organic that they're just asking him more because he's got something coming out and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame's coming up and he's just pissed off and letting people know?
Standard practice that you give people a little taste of what's in the book.
Yeah,
and that's almost certainly what he's doing.
You think he's going to bury those guys in the book?
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah.
No doubt about it. He's burying them in the preemptive interviews.
Yeah.
So. I mean, the book's going to just... the book's going to be naming names, man. Like Chris on episode 2 or 3.
What's
or whatever.
Are you calling Nick Menza a child molester?
Falsely.
What's the name of the book?
It's Face the Music, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Face the Music. So... And it's got Paul Stanley's face on it.
They've all had, in my opinion, pretty lame names of their books.
I thought, wait, let's see, what is it here? I thought Peter's was the best. Makeup to Breakup.
Which is from You Wanted the Best from Psycho Circus.
No Aces, Regrets is dumb.
Aces is No Regrets, I think all four of their books have lame titles.
Jesus, Kiss and Makeup.
That's dumb.
Yeah, all lame.
Dumb.
It is dumb.
It is.
Fuck them.
Yeah. All right. Well, hey, that's it for today. Thanks for listening. We appreciate it. Share some of your insight on Facebook or on Twitter. Until next time.
Charlie Sheen's terrible.
But he's great in movies.
He has been in the past.
Right, so what's wrong with that?
He's a complete waste.
But he's been great in movies.
He has been.
So you can't take that away from the guy.
They can't take that away from me.
Exactly.
Turn it up louder! Shout it, shout it, shout it.